Good afternoon. Shall we begin? It's my pleasure and privilege, great privilege, to introduce this afternoon's speaker, Professor Ramakrishna Ramaswamy, currently at Delhi IIT as visiting professor. Ram, who is a close friend of ours, is one of the most eminent academicians of this country. Tomorrow morning, he's here as chief guest for the RSIC program, so I thought I should slip in a little plug for that as well. You're all invited to that in ICSR auditorium. Ram had his undergraduate education at Loyola College, and then went to Kanpur IIT to join their MSc program in chemistry, following which he went to Princeton University for graduate studies, got his PhD in 1978, and then he was a postdoc at Caltech, after which he returned to Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in Bombay, where he spent several years till the call of the siren call of universities, of education beckoned him, and he joined the then newly formed School of Physical Sciences at JNU and was instrumental in setting it up to its present state of eminence. I said advisedly one of the most eminent academicians of this country because he's a true polymath, and it's not clear whether one should introduce him primarily as a chemist or a physicist or a mathematician or a computer scientist or a biologist, because his work has bearing on all these subjects. And truly, he's a polymath with wide interests and a very large area of swath of knowledge in which he has worked in done fundamental research. My own first encounter with him came in the 80s when I realized that he had essentially brought it brought chaos into the country. he brought a specific brand of chaos, Hamiltonian chaos, into the country. Until then, I was unaware of what Hamiltonian chaos was. But he had done seminal work on this, including on quantum chaos subsequently. And then he has gone on to do a huge amount of work in many, many areas. He's received numerous honors. He's a fellow of all the academies of science, as well as the Third World Academy of Sciences. He served as vice president of INSA and of the Indian Academy of Sciences. And very lately, he's just stepped down as the past president of the Indian Academy of Sciences in Bangalore. Above all, the quality that I associate with Ram is extreme clarity, very precise in his statements, but at the same time, he makes it look all so easy. Even though it's a very complex concept, he has the talent for quote-unquote bringing it down without really compromising on rigor or correctness to the level of even undergraduate students. He's been an extremely successful thesis advisor. He has more than 35 PhD students to his credit. And last year, when he retired, formally at the age of mandatory age of 65, we were all wondering as to which place is going to be lucky enough to have his continued presence, and it turns out to be Delhi IIT. Well, lucky for them. I won't stand further between you and the speaker. He's going to speak on a topic of very close to my heart personally. He's going to speak on chance, and hopefully he will also touch upon necessity. Thank you. Ram.
After such a generous introduction, the inevitable fear is that it's all going to be a big letdown and it's going to go rapidly downhill from here. So you have been warned. Right? Thank you very much, Bala, and thank all of you. It's a great pleasure to be at IIT Madras, and also a pleasure to give a talk in a hall named after Newton, and that too in an applied mechanics department. I keep, at IIT Delhi, I keep trying to justify my existence there, and now I can say I've gone and given a talk in applied mechanics. You can't get more engineering than that. But this talk is on chance, and the title, of course, Chance Ki Baat, is occasionally it allows me to address a group as diverse as this with Mitron. I will talk about chance. But as Bala mentioned to you, I'm at IIT Delhi, but I have for many years taught at the Jawaharlal Nehru University. The reference to JNU is not there, but it's in the color. So this talk is really about chance, and it's a technical talk. It's on, you know, dynamics and mathematics and so on and so forth. But before that, I mean, I just want to introduce the concept. Chance is a very necessary, it's a necessary idea that we all sit and play with. And it's very closely tied into the idea of contingency. And contingencies are things that you guard yourself for. I mean, if you're a faculty member, you also have contingency expenses, you know, so you keep that. But a contingency is a future event or circumstance which is possible, but which cannot be predicted. And in a sense, it doesn't, you know, Bala said I should talk about necessity. So chance is the absence, or contingency is the absence of necessity, that something could be this, but it doesn't have to be this, all right? You know, sort of good illustration of that is that this is a non-contingent event. If I should drop this object, it will definitely fall down, and there's no way in which it can fall up. That's not, there is no contingency that it would go up. Whereas there will be events which we will discuss where you can have more than one possible outcome. So, again, from JNU, it is therefore necessary, you know, to my allegiance to the Tukde Tukde gang, and as frequently introduced as an urban Naxal, all this is important. But Engels famously said that freedom is the recognition of necessity. All right, this is early part of Marxist theory. This statement was modified by a personal hero of mine, who is D.D. Kosambi. And he said that science is the cognition of necessity. What this means precisely takes a little more elaboration, but I will just point it out to you because Kosambi was both important as an Indian Marxist and an Indian historian and a mathematician. And sort of he thought deeply about this. So finally, I will say what chance is. Chance is the absence of necessity, the fact of being so without having to be so, right? So what exactly do I mean by this? Now, even though we use the word frequently in conversation and language and so on and so forth, it turns out that there are two kinds of senses in which we use the word chance. There's one which is epistemological. Just a fancy way of saying that if you don't know the initial conditions, if the chance event is because of your lack of knowledge about something, that is what we call epistemological chance. Namely, you know, I don't know when the train is coming. Oh, I forgot to look at the timetable, and anyhow, we don't know something, etc., etc. And then you miss the train. That was a chance, but it was because of your lack of knowledge. There are better examples that one can have. There's a second kind of chance, and that happens because it is intrinsic somehow to the system. And this is the one, for example, you know, all of stochasticity is, it, and such intrinsic chance is called ontological chance. Okay. You cannot get away from this kind of noise. I just want us to keep this kind of distinction in mind, because I will discuss both of them and the way in which they come about, right? Now, a lot of people have worried about chance. Many of you might have seen this book or read it by Jacques Monod, and you know, who got the Nobel Prize in biology many years ago. And the title of the book is Chance and Necessity, right? So the fact that we are here, and that will be what I close this talk with, there has been a huge element of chance in us being here today, because nature seems to rely a lot on chance and not on, I mean, there is evolution, of course, but evolution itself relies a lot on chance, in a sense in which I'll make it more distinct. Very well-known Indian statistician, C.R. Rao, he has a very nice book called Statistics and Truth. So he says the chance may be the antithesis of all law. But maybe there is a law underlying chance, and we have to worry a little about that. Now, we are used to using chance. And one example which many of you might have seen is the example of the Buffon needle. Does this ring a bell? Some bell, right? So the idea is that you would have a needle and you drop it on a floor made with, in this example, pieces of wood. So you have boundaries between alternate planks. And you drop it on the floor and you want to know what is the probability that this will intersect a boundary. Okay, so it can fall either in a way that you don't intersect the boundary or in a way that you do. Right? So this is one of the early examples where chance was used, you know, because when you drop it on the floor, you don't know, and as it happened over here, it didn't intersect any particular boundary, but you can calculate, and a small, very elementary calculation shows that the probability of intersecting, okay, depends on the distance between the two lines, which is T, the length of the needle, which is L, all right? See, it will intersect only if it falls close enough and if it falls at the right angle, all right? So it turns out that that's the value of the integral. It can be calculated. And better still, if you drop the needle N times, and it crosses the boundary C, the number of times it crosses the boundary is C, then this gives you a way of calculating pi. I mean, this is like an early example of the Monte Carlo method physically there for you, right? And if you actually take a needle and drop it, either a real needle or you can go to the internet, you'll find Buffon experiments galore. You can just drop millions of needles and you will find, excuse me, that you can calculate approximately the value of pi, right? And you get a reasonable value, and those who have suffered through my class on computational physics in JNU or elsewhere, this is an example that one uses. All right, so this was just to normalize and say that we use chance in a variety of ways all the time. But what is our intrinsic idea about chance? The reason why this is important is that in biological systems, or in the in particularly one arena where this concept is crucial one place where this is crucial is in biology. Even anecdotally, you should be aware that there are many, many things that have happened in biology which have happened only once. For example, life on this planet happened once. Thanks. So this is one very, striking fact that on our planet, you had life happening once. Every time there is a mutation or a speciation, new species are created, it happens by random selection, by random modification of the DNA and then descent. The transition from single cellular to multicellular organisms, again, that seems to have happened once, right? And so these are, incredibly low probability events that have happened. And, the dinosaurs were killed by a random celestial phenomenon. A meteor came and hit Mexico some, 65 odd million years ago. And if that had not happened, I could still have been giving a talk, one doesn't know. All right. Okay, so this is really all background as to why this should be a problem of some interest to all of us, regardless of precisely which discipline. So the way in which we describe the physical world is through a variety of, you know, very nice deterministic laws, and, you know, Newton again, you know, so all our laws are characterized by beauty and elegance and determinism. Everything is rather well known. But increasingly over the last several years, several decades, it turns out that the right mathematics with which you describe the world around us is really nonlinear. And no better place to say it in a department of applied mechanics, that you have to have nonlinear descriptions of the world around you. And I'm not going to sort of say, you know, what we need in terms of, you know, planetary motion or any such thing like that. But most of the time, we, you know, you stay with linear approximations, many of which are not even accurate. And Einstein, for example, has said that as far as the laws of mathematics refer to physical reality, they are not certain. And as far as they are certain, they don't refer to reality. All right? Okay, the context was slightly different in this particular case, but, you know, just pointing it out. Sort of the hallmark of chaos theory is really a question like this. If the world is described by somewhat simple laws and, you know, some Navier-Stokes equation and so on and so forth, just cross the computational fluid dynamics department over here. Why is it so difficult to predict the weather? I mean, who would have thought that it would rain yesterday? So basically, nonlinear science is the way in which you're going to have to describe the world around you and various phenomena, including the weather and so on and so forth. And the mathematics, it just turns out that the moment you add nonlinearity, there seems to be a way in which every solution completely changes, right? And this has an implication not just for the basic sciences, but also for technology, all right? And really, the discovery about, I don't know, now 50 years ago, a little more than 50 years ago, 1963 is some date in this, the history of this business, people discovered that simple deterministic equations can have solutions which are extremely irregular, and the implications of this over long periods of time and in space can be pretty severe. It turns out, for example, that even simple systems can behave almost exactly like a random coin toss, all right? So there is a sense in which even the simplest systems, the solutions of these systems can be irregular and unpredictable. All right. Now this is the, I mean, I'm sure that this has been seen by many of you at some point in time or the other, but this is the kind of system that is almost linear. There are only two sources of nonlinearity, that term there and that term over there. So with two nonlinear terms, this is not the simplest set of equations that can show this kind of behavior, but nevertheless, I'm going to use this to come to the concepts that I would like to discuss, all right? Now, if you take these equations and solve them on a computer over any length of time, you will get a solution that looks like the image that you have over there. It's the Lorentz butterfly. Okay, so this is a famous solution. It's famous because of its shape. It's called the Lorentz butterfly. And again, just to normalize it, because I know that there are many of you who would have seen it and are, you know, sick and tired of it. But nevertheless, these are solutions of these particular equations. And hidden in that is some incredible kind of complexity. The solution over time winds over both, if you think of these as two parts of a, two wings of a butterfly, all right, because it kind of looks like that. The solution goes over one wing for some time, and then it goes over the other wing for some more time, and so on and so forth. It just keeps going, for it will always be there, all right? Now, that is not in two dimensions, it's in three dimensions, because it cannot, if it was in two dimensions, it would cut itself, and that's not allowed. just by the theory of differential equations, you can't have solutions that will intersect themselves. Thanks. Okay, so you're winding around for some time on this, and then on this, and then on this, and so on and so forth, right? Okay. All right, just again to normalize, because many of you would have seen this before, what Lorentz discovered was that if you start at this particular point and color your trajectory, let's say red, you will wind around for a little while over here and then on this and so on and so forth, and you would eventually land up over there. But if you were to start at almost the same point, almost meaning that you'll have a small difference in your initial condition, and you color your trajectory blue, you just go and you land up over here. So the idea that was introduced by Lorentz, and which is endemic to every nonlinear system, or almost every nonlinear system, is that solutions can show sensitivity to initial conditions, right? And this is what we call chaos, right? So this is the basic idea over here. Now, Lorentz discovered this. He called that it was, showed that it was chaos, and you know the difference grows exponentially. But if you start from the blue point, you will go on to the butterfly. If you start on the red point, you also go on to the butterfly. So no matter where you start in space, you eventually go on to the butterfly. And this gave a very important idea, and that is of an attractor. All right? So you have an attractor. The motion itself is sensitive to initial conditions, but there is a sense in which any initial condition comes onto the butterfly, which is the attractor of the dynamics. So when you have this combination of sensitivity to initial condition on the butterfly, but attraction of the butterfly, this concept is called, this object is called a strange attractor. All right? So you have strange attractors frequently when you have nonlinearity, but you also need contraction, so you need dissipation. So when you have systems with friction, particularly, you can expect this kind of behavior. But you can actually expect a little more. It turns out that you don't always have one attractor. You have many, you can have many attractors. And schematically, the sensitive dependence on initial conditions means or can mean something like this. But supposing you had four attractors, as I've just schematically shown over here. If you start at this point, maybe you go to attractor B, all right? If you start at this blue point over here, you go to this attractor. You start over here, you go to attractor A. You start very close by, you may go to attractor C, and you start over here, you can go to attractor D, and so on and so forth, all right? So different points can lead you to different attractors. What are all the points that go to attractor A? That's called the basin of A. What are all the points that go to B? The basin of B, and so on and so forth. So the idea is that you can have many attractors, the dynamics can be complicated, and you can have complicated basins of attraction. Right? Now, when you have many attractors coexisting and different initial conditions will lead to different attractors, you have a phenomenon which is called multistability, right? And multistability is the existence of two or more exclusive, stable, attracting states. Now, if you look at that cube, some of you are seeing it as coming out of the screen, and some of you are seeing it as going into the screen, right? This edge, is it outside? For whom is it outside? For whom is it inside? Now look at it long enough, it can go from inside to outside. Okay, this is a very famous cube, and this is an experiment in psychology. This is called the Necker cube. But this is an example of multi-stability for you. You have two attractors. The attractors are coming out of the screen or going into the screen, right? And the different sets of people are just different initial conditions. For some initial conditions, you all went to the outward coming in attractor. For some, you went to the inward. But because of multi-stability, you have, you know, and this is because your environment is fluctuating a little, right? You're looking at it, you get a little doze and whatnot, and then suddenly, oh my God, it's coming out of the screen. It was going in, right? So the point is that multi-stability forms the basis of what engineers love to make switches, right? If you have two states and the ability to make transition between the states, this is a very important kind of idea that exists, that you can have multiple stable states and you'd like to be able to make a transition between them. That is the basis of many, many switches. Not just that one, but especially biological switches, which people are interested in. Okay? All right, so I hope you're beginning to see where I'm leading up to. Most equations that describe the world around us or are of interest are nonlinear. Nonlinear systems have attractors. These attractors can be one, can be many. And when you have many attractors, they have basins, and these basins can have interesting properties. I'm going to show you a little more about it, but I'm sort of just giving you the way forward. All right. Now, the Lorentz system, which is over here again, right, is actually a remarkably beautiful set of equations. Okay, remarkably beautiful only because, first of all, it's a truncation of the Navier-Stokes equation, and the Navier-Stokes is remarkable and beautiful and important and every such thing. Okay, but it has a certain kind of symmetry. You see, there's a symmetry which takes x, y, and z to minus x, minus y, and z, and the equations are invariant. All right, so there are some very interesting properties that such a system will have. There are symmetric solutions, and it turns out that because it has this equivariance and the symmetries, it's actually susceptible to multi-stability. Discussing multi-stability in Lorentz is a very long topic, but I mean, I will just basically point out to you that if I take these equations and ask, what are the stationary points, what are the fixed points, right? That is, when x dot, y dot, and z dot are all equal to zero, you can see immediately that there is one solution, which is x equals y equals z is equal to zero. All right? And there are two other fixed points because you get a quadratic equation on solving it, and they have this nice little structure over there. What it is precisely, if anyone is interested, there are whole books written on this equation. So you can see it over there. The parameter over here, R, is like a Rayleigh, it's like a Rayleigh number. In the Navier-Stokes, what would have been the Rayleigh number, when it comes down to the Lorentz, it becomes the parameter R. And as you change R, it turns out that these two fixed points, C plus and C minus, they are stable from the point 1 over here all the way up till R is equal to 24.74. There is a hop bifurcation at that point. There is a bifurcation, meaning a change in behavior, that happens at this value of R. And over this region, C plus and C minus are both stable. Beyond this, it turns out, everything is unstable. All the fixed points are unstable in this system. And the only stable solution is the strange attractor that Lorentz discovered. Lorentz worked at R is equal to 28, which is somewhere over here. All right. Now, in this region, you have both the strange attractor and these fixed points, which are both stable. And you can ask, you've got, in this particular region, the stable fixed points and the strange attractor coexist. You've got three attractors in the system. What do their basins look like? What are the points that go to one or the other or the other? And it turns out that the basins actually have a very beautiful structure. All the, you know, I've just taken a plane. This is because it's a three-dimensional thing. I've just taken a plane. And all the yellow points go to one fixed point. All the green points go to another fixed point. And all the blue points go to the chaotic attractor. Right? Okay. Now, this is just a small slice of this plane, so there are many, many more blue, green regions and yellow regions, and the whole thing is just beautifully covered over with, so you understand that this is a slice of the basin of attraction, all right? And now, since you can buy a 3D printer and make one, somebody actually did. I wish I had done it. I mean, it's a pointless but cool thing to do. This is just to show you how these basins are in space. They, you know, what we've done over here is to just take a cut of this and show it. So this is just a cut, right? So if you were to continue the yellow lobe through space as it goes around and around, it would look something like this, right? So the whole of three-dimensional space, wherever you start, you have to go somewhere. So all these points will go to the fixed point. Another set of points will go to the other fixed point. And the remaining points will all go to the chaotic attractor. And all these are tied one to the other. So these are the three basins for this particular system. And once you've got chaotic attractors and fixed points and what have you, you can immediately ask all sorts of questions. What are these basins like? Are they smooth basins? Are the boundaries smooth? Right? Namely, that if I start over here, I go to one point. If I start on this side, do I go to another point? It turns out that topologically, there's a very interesting property that these basins have. And one of them is called the Wada property. The Wada property is not from Tamil, it's Japanese. It's not an allurement to study the subject. It could be, though. The basin that has the property that every neighborhood of every point on the boundary of that basin intersects at least three basins. About 100 years ago, this Japanese mathematician called Wada, he showed this particular construction where he constructed these regions, and they are called the lakes of Wada. Right? They have this Wada property. And what I'm going to come to is really, are these riddled? What is, you know, this idea of riddling and so on and so forth, but let me come to that. So this is what basin boundaries can look like. This is a picture from somebody else's work, a Maryland group of people. So all the red points go to one attractor, all the blue points go to some other attractor, all the yellow points go to some other attractor. And you can see that these are all very strongly intertwined, and they're obviously, they've got interesting geometries. It turns out that they can be fractal, but you don't have to go very far for that. Another favorite exercise in computational physics, at least, is to find the roots of unity. So the three roots of unity that occur over here, when I take this complex equation z cubed is equal to 1, as we know, there are three roots, 1, and then e to the I pi, and e to the 2 I pi, by 3. 1/3 pi and 2/3 pi, these three roots. And these three roots are there, there, and there, or at these three points on the circle. Now, if one is to write the Newton-Raphson method for solving this particular system, you can ask, if I start from an initial condition over here, where do I go? And what is shown over here are the basins of attraction of these three roots of unity. And as you can see, all these yellow points go over here, and all the yellow points over here go over here, all the purple ones go on that side, all the blue ones come over here. And the boundaries of these regions, so any point on the boundary of the purple region contains at least some neighborhood of yellow and some neighborhood of blue. All right? So if you were to start on this side, you would definitely go to this particular point. But if you were to start ever so close on this particular boundary, you would actually land up going here. Or you might even land up going over here. So you have a lot of uncertainty, not in your initial state, but a lot of uncertainty in your final state. Okay? Right. Now, you can be a little more, things can get a little more complicated. And this is the idea of riddling. If you start with initial conditions leading to a given attractor, just call it A. If every neighborhood of every point in A contains some point in some other attractor, then you say that A is riddled with respect to B. So every point of A has got at least some points of B close by. So A, all right, is the idea there that every point of one attractor, somewhere close by, there's a point going to another attractor. Now, if A is riddled with respect to B, and B also is riddled with respect to A, then you have something even more interesting, and these are called intermingled basins. So here is a typical example of intermingling. All the black points go to one attractor, all the white points go to another attractor. And I take a small region of that and I blow it up. And again, you see it looks exactly like the original picture. All the black points are going to one attractor. Initial conditions leading to these two different attractors are so close, they're as close as rational to irrational numbers, right? No matter where you have a rational number, there's an irrational number close by, and vice versa. So this kind of intermingling, right, makes it very difficult, because any improvement in either numerical or experimental precision is not going to help you to predict the final state. Okay, so I'm almost at the punchline of this part of my talk. So basically to tell you that if I take two Lorentz systems and couple them, right? If I take a single Lorentz system at this point, there's only a single attractor. But if I take two of them and couple them, all right, it turns out that on coupling, the system actually has three coexisting attractors. These used to be fixed points and they were unstable. But if you actually blow them up and look at it, they now are actually substantial chaotic attractors. And it turns out that the initial conditions that go from one to the other, they can be as complicated as this. You know, the basins are completely intermingled, right? And in this system, you can have any number of attractors, it turns out. So let me tell you what all this is adding up to. So given a multistable system where you have intermingled attractor basins, it's impossible to predict the final state. It's impossible, all right? This final state sensitivity is characterized by something called an uncertainty exponent. And the uncertainty exponent basically says, I take an initial condition, and in a circle of radius d, I look at all sorts of initial conditions over there. How many of them go to another attractor? And as I keep making that circle smaller and smaller and smaller, the fraction doesn't change, right? So regardless of how small my circle of around my initial conditions is, I'm always uncertain as to where my final state is going to be. And this final state uncertainty or final state sensitivity is a very natural way in which chance arises in deterministic dynamical systems. No, the sensitivity of the final state to the initial state. You see, if you take the Lorentz system by itself, the final state is not sensitive to any initial condition. On the attractor, two points will diverge, but any two points will go on to the same object. All right? So this is termed final state sensitivity in the sense that no matter where you start, where you end up is so uncertain. All right? So basic point, even when the because the basins are so strongly intermingled. Right? Okay. Okay, so when the equations are known, the parameters are known, there's no uncertainty anywhere. But you cannot predict your initial conditions to mathematical infinite precision. Therefore, you will always be uncertain as to where you're going to come. And so let me just, the punchline is this, that the basis of this, you know, what we call epistemological chance, your lack of knowledge of initial conditions, is really a way of saying that you've got outcomes or attractors which have got essentially intermingled basins of attraction, and a small change will lead you anywhere. Right? Now, I mean, okay, so, I mean, this is not a, I mean, this is a way of in which I think about the origin of chance. You've got multiple attractors, and this is what happens. All right? So, the basis of epistemological chance is coexisting attractors with intermingled basins of attraction. All right? Now, one of the most common ways in which we use chance is at the beginning of every IPL match. Somebody comes out, and I don't have a coin, otherwise I would demonstrate it. You know, you toss a coin and you get either heads or tails. What are the two attractors of this system? I mean, after all, it is a disk to which you give some initial velocity, some initial angular momentum, right? And it comes down on either heads or tails, and those are the two attractors of the system. What are all the initial conditions that will lead to heads? The basin, and vice versa. Now, I have a strong suspicion that the basins are not intermingled, right? Which is when you have match fixing and all that. But what I'm saying is that this is one place where you've got two attractors and the outcomes are immediately. You've got a die with six faces. Which die shows up is one out of six attractors. Your initial conditions are really, again, the velocity and your angular momentum that you apply to it and so on. So what I'm, you know, so this is where I would say is the basis of epistemological chance. Now, I also pointed out that there was another kind of chance, and that was the ontological one, or, you know, the one to do with stochasticity. And I've already told you that, you know, chance plays a major role in biology. And it turns out that this is a system where stochasticity is fundamental at all scales. Forget the human ecological, because you must have, we are all sensitive to the fact that small changes somewhere have made life or have a huge impact on life. For example, you know, the climate change and, you know, that sort of, so that from that scale all the way down to the cellular and the subcellular level, there is stochasticity. And the reason for this is largely to do with size. See, cells are small. That's 5 microns. This is 5 micrometers over here. That's the size of the typical length scale of a cell. And when you've got an object that is like a little nano reactor, right, then you can see that a cell has got a lot of diversity, and as a matter of fact, it's small, it's crowded, and it's noisy. And we'll just discuss the origin of that kind of noise. It's noisy largely because all the majority of forces that are present inside a small assembly like that are non-bonding, they're electrostatic. Molecules that are inside the cell, we may not be, you know, always used to thinking about it, but a cell is a kind of a small place, and most of the time stuff just sticks on to each other. All right. But the total amount inside a cell is, if you do a calculation and you know that it's 70% water, the total number of molecules inside there, it turns out to be approximately 10 to the 14. Very far from the macroscopic world. To a fair approximation, the amount of water which is there in a glass is 10 to the 23. All right, so we are talking about 7 to 8 orders of magnitude below this. Now, inside this cell, stuff is actually very crowded. And it's a wonder how molecules find each other. Not quite a wonder, I mean, this is just a matter of speaking, okay? People have figured it out. Things move by molecular motors, there is diffusion, there is a complex variety of processes that happen inside a cell. And this is the origin of the other kind of noise, eventually, right? The stochasticity, because of the way in which you have diffusion through these various channels and the orientation with which each particular molecule might arise can make the sort of resulting processes difficult. In particular, even if you asked a simple question like how in a noisy environment do chemical reactions take place? You know, when we think about a chemical or a biochemical reaction or anything like so, how does it happen? At the heart of it, okay, and the reason why it's important is that, you know, and cells is just a one place to look at it. I could have easily said this entire thing is there inside a nanostructure, inside a zeolite, or on a interstellar dust grain, or what have you. Any place where the number of molecules is low, very low, or low, much, much below Avogadro. Okay, so we're talking in that regime. How does one model such processes, and how does one look at kinetics of reactions? Okay, so I'll be a little brief, but because I want to get a certain point across, and that is that if I take a typical idea of chemical kinetics, chemical kinetics is thought of as bimolecular reactions. A becomes X. X interacts with some B and it makes Y. Again, X and Y can interact with each other and maybe there's catalysis. And so this is a famous model. It's called the brucellator, right? And, you know, so, and these are all happening at a certain rate. Now, traditionally, when people say that something happens at a particular rate, what this is usually averaging over is that when, let us say, you know, B plus X goes to Y plus C. So if B plus X goes to Y plus C, this B and this X can be meeting at various relative orientations. They can be meeting at various relative velocities. All these are averaged over, and the probability that you will create a particular reaction product Y and C, that is encapsulated in a particular number. This is the rate of the reaction. Right? Now, this integrates into the whole description a whole series of concepts, namely that reactions happen on one by one meeting at a particular orientation and so on and so forth. Now, more complicated reactions can also be studied, and they give equations like so. We've already seen Lorentz and so on. All right. But because the cell is much smaller than Avogadro, when the numbers of these molecules are small, one has to look at very microscopic descriptions. All right? So the point is that chemical reactions are random events, especially when there's only one or two of these molecules. And hopefully you can appreciate the fact that inside a cell, the numbers are very small. It's not as if you've got hundreds of molecules coming and meeting each other. There's one, two, three, like that there are. So you find that you'll have, you know, you have a reaction, and then you have so-and-so A and B, and then you could also have the reverse reaction taking place. But these are described as Poisson processes because they are meeting each other randomly and interacting randomly. So the time between these various events is Poisson distributed, and the rate, you know, appears in this exponent over here. So the probability that the interval is less than some delta 1 is e to the minus lambda x, all right? And this rate of this Poisson process is given by lambda with an average inter-event time of 1 over lambda, all right? Now, when you study kinetics, when you study processes like this, it turns out that what you have to do is to see these in terms of number of molecules, and these are Poisson processes. What this means basically is that you don't have concentrations. You have either 10 molecules of A. When there's a reaction, it becomes 9 molecules, and there's another reaction, it's 8 molecules. And inside the cell, this is actually germane because you've got one DNA or a few RNA or other such species, all right? Okay, so like I said, there are many contexts in which you can think about this. If you have multiple reactions, it turns out you have concurrent Poisson processes, again, concurrent random processes. And these then can be modeled also in the same way, where, you know, you can, if this is the forward reaction, A is decreasing by 1, but then if you have the backward reaction, A increases by 1, and so on and so forth, okay? Now, this is the way in which one has to model and think about, especially biological processes inside cells, because of this fact that I told you, that a lot of these interactions happen by diffusion, and they happen essentially randomly, all right? So let me just basically sort of summarize this, that given the system at a specific time, one needs to ask the following two questions. What is the time to the next reaction? It turns out to be a Poisson random process. Which of those reactions, there are n of those reactions, which one is it going to be? That also turns out to be a random process. When the next reaction will happen, because of this inherent stochasticity of the system, this turns out to be a matter of chance. And which reaction will also, you know, if there are m possible reactions, then it turns out that the probabilities of these happening also, has a certain kind of distribution. And so which reaction will also be a matter of chance. All right. I've been a little glib in sort of describing this whole thing because this is the, you know, this is generally a subject of fairly detailed description. This was first discussed by Gillespie in 1977 as to how to take an ensemble of many different species and many different reactions and how to deal with them all, all right? And this is now called the Gillespie method of the Gillespie. Just to give you an idea, the flavor of what happens. If you have the following four reactions, this is called the Schogel model, and the kinetics can be described by this particular rather simple looking equation, which can be solved. If you solve it analytically, the solution that you get is so. Treating this as four chemical reactions in the same way with the Poisson processes and the probability of this happening and so on, if you do that, you find that each one of these individual thin lines over here is a different realization of what happens. Right? And if you take an average, that average looks more or less like that. And this average is another set of initial conditions, looks more or less like the deterministic solution. Right? So here, there's another example. Right? So in cells, small environments, these are dominated by large fluctuations because of the way in which these events will occur. And this kind of stochasticity, which is not to do with either non-linearity, it doesn't have to do with basins of attraction, it doesn't have to do with anything else except for the fact that you are in a situation where you are just dominated by probability over here of meeting and interacting. This is what gives rise to this second kind of chance, which is just intrinsic, it is ontological, it's just basic to the whole thing. And nonlinearity is not crucial in this context. And you know, for those who might be interested, I just want to point out that many of the reactions that happen in interstellar space, and you know that there are molecules that can be found in space, right? How do they happen? Because the density of outer space is essentially zero, right? So there are these dust grains that are floating around, and on the dust grains, occasionally a molecule will come and get absorbed, and then it will just wait for a really long time for another molecule to come. It might land up on another part of the dust grain, so then you have to wait for it to diffuse, and then the reaction takes place. The fact that you can actually make complex molecules like that says that it happens. But the universe has a very long time. So all this has happened over many, many time scales. But this is the basic theory of interstellar chemistry, is these random processes. Okay? So it's not just inside cells, also in interstellar space. All right. So let me summarize, because it's late enough. So one of the reasons that I personally got interested in this whole idea of chance is that I work in dynamical systems and in computational biology, and one wonders how all this came to be. So from Darwin onwards, because Darwin did think deeply about it, the central lesson of biology is that life itself is a game of chance. And what causes it? It could be a context. It could be some meteor that fell and what have you. It could be global warming. It could be an ice age. So what happens, what causes it to happen could be just the context. And so that is, the rest of it is value added. So I just want to leave you with some ideas from Jacques Monod. Right? Life appeared on Earth. Obviously, we are here. Right? So what before the event, was there a chance that this would occur? And the, what is known in 1970 and even now, is that the structure of the biosphere doesn't exclude the possibility that this event happened only once. The a priori probability of it happening, therefore, was just zero. Right? So the universe wasn't pregnant with life, nor for that matter was, after having created life, we had the biosphere, but it wasn't immediately obvious that we'd come up with man. It just so happened that in the Monte Carlo game, our number came up, all right? Okay, so to summarize, chance and contingency play a very fundamental role in natural sciences at many, many scales. I haven't even touched about quantum mechanics and the role of uncertainty in that. That's a completely different way of thinking about things over there. So I haven't touched about it. This is just purely classical systems. Whether it is the thing, whether it's the singularity of events like the origin of life or what have you, noise can really influence outcomes, right? And many, many systems are complex because they are nonlinear and they allow distinct dynamical states to coexist, starting with the coin which has these two states and so on and so forth. So in such systems, the possibility that small changes in your initial conditions can give you very different outcomes, this gives very complex patterns in space and time. And it is also my belief that by exploiting this kind of complexity, a system can explore new kinds of behavior and variety, right? So to just the final statement, so whether or not it derives from processes that follow deterministic laws, and we've seen examples of that, chance is a fundamental and unavoidable reality. Now, this should be seen as a good thing, because if it wasn't a good thing, we wouldn't be here to discuss it. Thank you for your attention.